in toxicology we are starting with an important topic, toxic gases. These toxic gases have been classified into three categories. The simple asphyxiants means these are the gases which displace the oxygen from the ambient air and reduces the partial pressure of available oxygen. For example, these are the gases like carbon dioxide, nitrogen, aliphatic hydrocarbon gases like butane, ethane, methane, propane, and various noble gases means argon, helium, neon, radium. These are the gases which decreases or displaces the required oxygen from the environment, and that oxygen is not available for the person. Then respiratory irritants, these are the gases which damages the respiratory tract by destroying the integrity of the mucosal barriers. Examples: ammonia, chlorine, heavy metal related all the gases, and zinc chloride, zinc oxide. These are the gases which damage the respiratory passage. Systemic asphyxia means having the systemic effects over the body. These gases produce significant systemic gases, systemic toxicity by specialized mechanism. The example of these gases are carbon monoxide, cyanide, smoke, etc. So first in that series which is of importance is carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is colorless, odorless, non-flammable gas which is heavier than air. In its solid form, which is known as dry ice, it is whitish in color and acts as a corrosive. This particular gas has been used in fire extinguishers, carbonation of soft drinks, as a shielding gas during welding process, and during synthesis of urea for dry ice and organic synthesis. Due to exposure of this gas, carbon dioxide, there is a clinical manifestation. This clinical manifestation are divided into four stages depending on the arterial oxygen saturation. When the oxygen saturation is 90%, that stage is called as an indifferent stage, which is characterized by reducing night vision. Next stage is compensatory stage, when the percentage of oxygen saturation is in between 82 to 90%. The particular stage is called compensatory stage. In this particular stage, body try to compensate by increasing the various physiological mechanism which is required for the life. Means if the saturation is between 82 to 90, oxygen saturation, there will be increased respiratory rate, compensatorily increasing the respiratory rate, subsequently increase in pulse, night vision is decreased, performance ability somewhat reduces due to the exhaustibility, alertness is reduced, symptoms may begin in those with significant pre-existing cardiac, pulmonary or hematological diseases. They are more prone if they are having pre-existing cardiorespiratory or hematological diseases. which is followed by disturbance state. When the oxygen saturation is in between 64 to 82%, then this disturbance stage is there. The body, which is trying to compensate by increasing the various physiological mechanism, this mechanism is inadequate, or there is more exposure, then this stage will occur. That is called as a disturbance stage, when the oxygen saturation is in between 64 to 82%. In this particular stage, person having the decrease in ability to escape from the toxic environment. This particular stage is characterized by various clinical manifestations like air hunger, fatigue, tunnel vision, dizziness, headache, visual acuity is more decreasing, hyperventilation, poor judgment, amnesia, and cyanosis. The critical stage, when the oxygen saturation is less than 70%, this particular stage is occur when the oxygen saturation is less than 70%. Death occurs when atmospheric oxygen concentration is reduced to 6 to 8% or less than. That is characterized by this particular stage is deterioration in judgment and coordination, which is for more than around 3 to 5 minutes or less. Total incapacitation and unconsciousness is very rapid. If the person is not moved from this environment or treatment is not given, then person will die in very shorter duration of time. Unconsciousness leading to death will occur when the atmospheric oxygen concentration is reduced to 6 to 8% or less. Concentration up to 35% of carbon dioxide have an exciting effect upon both circulation and respiration. Concentration above 35% have a depressing effect upon both circulation and respiration. Then management of this poison. Diagnosis is mainly depend upon arterial blood gas analysis. So arterial blood gas analysis are useful to assess the degree of hypoxemia, and the hypoxemia treatment of that hypoxemia is the mainstream in the management of carbon monoxide poisoning. First we have to assess the hypoxemia, then immediately move the patient from toxic environment to the fresh air. Monitor for respiratory distress. If cough or difficulty in breathing develop, evaluate for hypoxia, respiratory tract irritation, bronchitis and pneumonitis, which is to be followed by administration of 100% humidified supplemental oxygen. Perform endotracheal intubation, provide assisted ventilation if required. If hypoxia has severe prolonged, then careful evaluation for neurological sequelae and provide supportive treatment as indicated when there is prolonged exposure for this particular poison. If the person is exposed for the dry ice, the treatment of frostbite has to be performed. This freezing injury or freeze injury associated with dermal exposure to dry ice is unlike frostbite, in that the damage occurs within seconds and rewarming is not beneficial. Some investigators suggest that this freeze injury of this nature should be managed much like a thermal burn, and burn surgeon should be consulted in the more severe cases of this form of injury, do not institute rewarming unless complete rewarming can be assured. Refreezing of the tissue increases the tissue damage. Place affected area in water bath with having the temperature around 40 to 42 degrees Celsius for 15 to 30 minutes until this thawing is completed. Some authors suggest that an antibacterial like povidone iodine or hexachlorophene may be added to the water bath and correct systemic hypothermia. This is the management of carbon dioxide poisoning. This carbon dioxide is most cases are occurring accidentally, resulting from inadvertent building up of carbon dioxide in a confined space, having a poor ventilated environment, and dry ice generated a toxic concentration of carbon dioxide. This is the most commonly occurring in that particular environment. The next poison of importance is carbon monoxide. This is also called as a carbonic oxide, carbon oxide, or exhaust gas, or flue gas. These are the synonymous names of carbon monoxides. This particular poison is presumed previously for years. Only this poisoning is occurring in closed, poorly ventilated areas. Open air cases of carbon monoxide poisoning have been recently reported from various kind of watercraft, including houseboats, cabin, cruisers, skyboats. And this is a silent type of poison. Means person is unable to recognize whether he has been poisoned or not. So it is a silent type of poisoning. And one can kill by this poison even without recognition. This carbon monoxide is a gas which is in a pure form, is odorless, colorless, non-irritating, and lighter than air. The carbon monoxide is produced when sources of carbon such as fuel or wood have been burned and produced from incomplete combustion in a fuel burning device. The various sources of this poison are incomplete burning of almost any form of fuel, like wood, charcoal, gas, kerosene, or automobile exhaust, fires, paint remover, especially methylene chloride, tobacco smoke, or endogenous carbon monoxide resulting from heat degradation can never be reached to toxic level on its own. Normal carbon monoxide level in plasma is in a range of 1 to 5% and may rise up to 7 to 8% in smokers. And one should remember, electric appliances do not produce carbon monoxide. These are the few photographs of sources of carbon monoxide. Exhaust, water bowls, and who is at risk? Everyone is at risk, but especially the people using alternate heat source during power outage, or elderly, unborn babies, infants, individual with chronic heart disease, anemia, respiratory problem, personnel at fire scene, like firefighters or rescue workers, because of their work. Individual working with combustion engine or combustible gas indoors. Pets, industrial workers at pulp mill, steel foundries, plants producing formaldehyde and coke. They are the person who is at risk. And seasonally, if we will see, in a particular season, various equipments has been used to causes in cold weather hazard due to the insufficient ventilation. If we are using generators, gas or kerosene heated in rooms without proper ventilation, stoves, fireplaces that are improperly vented or blocked, exhaust fumes, or appliances, ducts that are blocked or sealed shut, car or truck idling in a garage, they are the more commonly exposed. In cold weather, there is poor function or worn part, appliances or equipment, heating system, improper use of using charcoal grill indoors, or heating homes with a gas oven. Improper use of certain equipments, or due to poor functioning or poorly placed equipments which are used in various weathers, are responsible for this poisoning. In warm weather, in poorly ventilated areas or enclosed areas, when these various kind of fuels or energy producing things has been used, or it is incompletely combusted, then this carbon monoxide will generate and causing the poisoning. And gasoline powered equipments, gas fuel lanterns and stoves burn inside a tent, boat, cabin without proper ventilation will causing the poisoning. This particular is usually poisoning. The fatal dose is expressed in terms of plasma concentration of the gas. The carboxyhemoglobin level exceeding 50 to 60% is potentially lethal. A carbon monoxide concentration of 5000 ppm in air is lethal to human after 5 minutes of exposure. One has to remember this statement. The lung avidly absorb carbon monoxide, which combines with hemoglobin. Around 85% is combined with hemoglobin and 15% with the myoglobin. And elimination occurs exclusively through the lungs. After the absorption, the carbon monoxide has the more affinity for hemoglobin, which is around 230 to 270 times greater than the oxygen. Therefore, in spite of adequate partial pressure of oxygen in the blood, there is a reduced arterial oxygen content. Further, carbon monoxide causes a leftward shift of oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, thus affecting the offloading of oxygen from hemoglobin to the tissue. The net results of all this, the decreased ability of oxygen to carried by the blood and released to the tissue. Means sufficient amount of oxygen cannot be delivered to the brain and other tissue. apart from this carbon carboxy hemoglobin mediated hypoxia, it is described or postulated that carbon monoxide may also interfere with the cellular respiration by inactivating the mitochondrial cytochrome oxidase. So all vital organs which are in need of oxygen are lacking for the oxygen, then will causing the poisoning, or this particular organ will affect by the hypoxia. It is poisonous to people and animals because it is displaced oxygen in the blood. So in the environment, sufficient amount of oxygen is available, it is of no use because of the attractiveness of hemoglobin towards the carbon monoxide is more as compared to the oxygen. It interferes with the oxygen distribution in the blood. The normal oxygenation of tetramer, that is 4 subunits hemoglobin molecule, as it goes from hemoglobin to oxyhemoglobin, the color change from blue as in venous blood, then to pink as in arterial blood. Here carbon monoxide enters the picture, and through its very high affinity for hemoglobin displaces the oxygen from the hemoglobin. This prevents oxygen being carried to the tissue and organ of the body. This prevents oxygen being carried to the tissues and organs of the body. And carboxyhemoglobin is reddish in color. The oxygen is carried from the lung by the blood hemoglobin to the tissue. Here the beating heart is shown and normal healthy oxidative metabolism goes on. In the second picture, during carbon monoxide poisoning, carbon monoxide is carried from the lung by the blood hemoglobin to the tissues, preventing oxygen from being carried and blocking normal oxidative metabolism. Note how slowly and weakly the heart is beating, since it is starved for the oxygen, that is blue in color. Means heart is in need of oxygen, but insufficient amount is there, means it is not properly working. Why do we need oxygen? It is very clear. Brain can only survive for few minutes without oxygen, and organs, all vital organs, brain, heart, are in need of oxygen. In carbon monoxide poisoning, there is more affinity of hemoglobin, which is carrying the oxygen, prevent the oxygen to be attached and to carry to particular tissue. In absence of oxygen, they are starved for the oxygen. Not more ATP can be produced, energy decreases, and the function of all vital organs will be decreases, and there is possibly death can occur if promptly and appropriately if patient is not treated. The toxic effect is depend upon the concentration and the time of exposure. If long term exposure to low level of carbon monoxide is equal to short term exposure to high level of carbon monoxide, that means the level of carbon monoxide into the environment as well as time of exposure, both are important. Carbon monoxide toxicity is due to cellular hypoxia or direct cellular injury. That that cellular hypoxia competes with oxygen for binding hemoglobin. Affinity of hemoglobin for carbon monoxide is more, around 250 times more affinity as compared to oxygen. The oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve shift to left, impaired tissue release of oxygen and cellular hypoxia. This is the pathophysiology. This particular curve will clearly show oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. That is hemoglobin saturation versus partial pressure of oxygen. The presence of carboxyhemoglobin shift the curve to the left and change it to a more hyperbolic shape. This results in a decrease in oxygen carrying capacity and impaired release of oxygen at the tissue level. Again, same. Direct cellular injury, CNS reoxygenation injury, lipid peroxygenation, free radical formation. Carbon monoxide and hemoglobin form carboxyhemoglobin, displace oxygen and leading to tissue hypoxia. As the partial pressure of oxygen in tissue falls, the amount of carbon monoxide entering the tissue and binding to cell hemoglobin such as myoglobin, cytochrome oxidase increases, which interferes interfering with their function. After the exposure and during the treatment with oxygen, higher partial pressure of oxygen is required. The sign and symptoms. The sign and symptoms are just like flu-like symptoms initially, but it is never be associated with running nose or fever. It is characterized by headache, fatigue, drowsiness, dizziness, shortness of breath, nausea, confusion or disorientation. Young children and elderly and household pets are usually affected first. This is the sequence of events. The first symptom of carbon monoxide poisoning is usually a tightness across the forehead, followed by headache and pounding of heart. A positive sign of progressive carbon monoxide poisoning is if the victim's face became extremely red, weariness, dizziness and mental changes in the form of dizziness, disorientation and loss of memory. However, if the carbon monoxide is very concentrated, the victim may pass without feeling any of these symptoms. If the concentration is more, then there will be no any manifestation. Patient line up into the deadly situation in that particular form. If the victim has severely exposed to carbon monoxide, symptoms may occur days or even weeks later, even if the victim at first appears to have fully recovered. This delayed symptoms include visual defects, characterized by blurring of vision, loss of sight, dizziness, profound change in emotions and will power, as well as mental changes in the form of depression. The various delayed neuropsychiatric syndromes are in the form of cognitive changes, personality changes, Parkinsonism, dementia, psychosis. The incidence of these neuropsychiatric symptoms is around 10 to 30% of victims 3 to 24 days after the exposure. This particular neuropsychiatric syndrome may appear. And recovery is around 50 to 75% within 12 months. Everyone is sick at same times, often mistake for a flu, food poisoning or other illnesses. Those sleeping or intoxicated can die before experiencing any symptoms. Prolonged exposure can lead to brain damage. Victims may become disoriented and unable to save themselves, because they are unable to recognize this situation and they are not able to move from the exposure site. When to presume the person is get exposed or by this poisoning? If everyone is sick at the same time, even the family pet, rather than the staggered day apart. Feel sick when in the area of concern, means particular area is involved for the carbon monoxide, then after going in that particular area, they feel sick, that is in particular room or kitchen or any other place. Better when they are away. Means they can presume they are getting exposed that particular poison. Diagnosis. Pulse oximetry cannot distinguish between hemoglobin saturated either with oxygen or either with a carbon monoxide. Pulse oximetry is a device which is acting or functioning depending upon the wavelength of that particular hemoglobin. It detects the wavelength. It is a non-invasive method of measuring saturation of hemoglobin, not the oxygen saturation. If the hemoglobin is get saturated, the wavelength is around 940 lambda. If not saturated, then the wavelength is around 660. The sensor which is having, and a specialized sensor is placed on the patient's finger, toe or nose. The sensor consists of light emitting diode and project two discrete wavelengths of light corresponding to the saturation and unsaturated hemoglobin together. So it just shows hemoglobin is saturated or not. Whether the hemoglobin is saturated with oxygen or carbon monoxide, that is not detected by pulse oximetry. So it is of no use in management of carbon monoxide poisoning. The arterial blood gases, partial pressure of oxygen is usually normal, but the oxygen saturation expressed as percentage is decreased. A gap between the measured percentage of oxyhemoglobin and calculated oxyhemoglobin indicate the necessity of measuring carboxyhemoglobin. PCO2 may be normal or slightly decreased, and there will be metabolic acidosis invariably present. The comprehensive neurological and neuropsychiatric assessment should be performed. Carbon monoxide neuropsychological screening is directory. CT brain to exclude other condition. High level of clinical suspicion should be there. Serum carboxyhemoglobin should be evaluated. exhaled breathing of carbon monoxide level should be measured. Blood should be carbon monoxide should be measured by spectrophotometry. That is the indicator. The estimation of carboxyhemoglobin. There is a normal level of range from 0 to 5, and it will be increased normally. This carboxyhemoglobin is around 10 in all heavy smokers. The spectrophotometrically reads the percentage of total hemoglobin saturated with carbon monoxide. Either arterial blood or venous blood can be taken, and that is correlated with the various clinical manifestations. The treatment. All the patients should be admitted immediately. One has to evaluate for various neurological signs. Routine investigation like chest X-ray, ECG, and blood investigation for the metabolic acidosis and for carboxyhemoglobin level should be measured. Patient should be immediately removed from the contaminated environment. Oxygen, 100% oxygen through tight fitting mask or endotracheal intubation should be given until carboxyhemoglobin falls to 15 to 20%. Onset of acute lung injury after toxic exposure may be delayed up to 24 to 72 hours after the exposure in some cases. This oxygen is the main therapy in carbon monoxide poisoning. 21% of oxygen is 4 to 6 hours, 100% oxygen for 40 to 80 minutes, and 100% oxygen under certain pressure, 2.5 atmospheric pressure, is for the 15 to 20 minutes. And continue oxygen until carbon monoxide, the oxyhemoglobin is get normal. Beware of concomitant smoke inhalation and burn injury. The hyperbaric oxygen means under pressure, if we are giving the oxygen, that is antidote, that is called as a hyperbaric oxygen. Several authorities consider administration of that hyperbaric oxygen is the very effective in carbon monoxide. It involves inhalation of oxygen at a pressure greater than 1 atmospheric absolute. 100% oxygen at ambient pressure reduces the half-life of carbon carboxyhemoglobin to 40 minutes, while at 2.5 atmospheres absolute, it is reduces just to 20 minutes. Means if we are increasing, if we are giving the oxygen under pressure, if it is 1 atmospheric pressure, the time required is 40 minutes. If it is around 2.5 atmospheric pressure, then time is reduced to 20 minutes. That hyperbaric oxygen should be instituted with 30 minutes of 100% at 3 ATA, followed by 2 ATA for 60 minutes until the carboxyhemoglobin is comes to normal or achieved around 10% as seen in all smokers. This is the chamber of hyperbaric oxygen which is given oxygen under pressure. This particular chamber for hyperbaric oxygen also increases the amount of dissolved oxygen by about 10 times, which is an additional benefit. Normally, a dramatic recovery of consciousness is seen during hyperbaric treatment. Patient remaining unconscious may be given further hyperbaric oxygen treatment, depending upon the recovery of the person and the level of carboxyhemoglobin. But it is not given in all cases. This hyperbaric oxygen indicated in this type of poisons, if the person is in comatose state, if carbon monoxide, carboxyhemoglobin is more than 40%, if there is neuropsychological disorders, if the person is pregnant, the patient is pregnant and carboxyhemoglobin level is more than 15%, if there is signs of cardiac ischemia or arrhythmia, history of ischemic heart disease or any high risk respiratory disease, and carboxyhemoglobin is more than 20%, there is occurrence or recurrence of the symptoms for more than 3 weeks, and symptoms that not resolve with normobaric oxygen for up to 4 hours is the indication for giving hyperbaric oxygen. Because this particular is decision to be taken with this particular indication of exposure by carbon monoxide. The autopsy features: the skin is cherry red in color, especially noticeable in areas of postmortem lividity in dark complexion individual. The color can be made out more easily in inner aspect of lips, nails bed, tongue, palm and soles. There is cutaneous bullae, as seen in barbiturate poisoning also, are sometimes seen in region of calf, buttock, wrist and knees. Cherry pink color of blood and tissues will be there if blood is diluted with water in a test tube and held against a light or a white background. The pink color will more easily made out. There will be pulmonary edema. If death is occurring delayed, means in delayed death, necrosis and cavitations of basal ganglion, especially in the area of globus pallidus and putamen, are commonly described features in various researchers. There is petechial and ring-shaped hemorrhage may be seen in white matter. Heart may show a focal area of necrosis. It is mandatory to collect blood for chemical analysis, preferably from the peripheral veins. And the blood should be appropriately preserved for the chemical analysis. This is the postmortem lividity, cherry red color. This cherry red color lividity over the body. It is particularly well recognized in fair skinned people, but in dark skinned people, the area of to look for lips, nail, tongue, palms and soles, where one can able to identify or differentiate the color. Carbon monoxide, easy to diagnose and treat if you think of it, but it is not able to recognize, then person will die. This cherry red color lividity will be seen. This particular kind of lividity will be occurring in carbon monoxide poisoning, cyanide poisoning or due to hypothermia. Thank you.
झालंय
सर. इथून काय नाही करायचं का?
करतो